Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ant Architecture, The Wonder, Beauty, and Science of Underground Nests by Walter R. Tschinkel, narrated by Tom Perkins. Publisher's note, in this audio edition you will hear references to illustrations, figures, images, graphs, and tables present in the print and ebook formats of this book. Preface. If you wanted to be an explorer ferreting out the undiscovered wonders of North America, you would be way too late. Sure, there might be small patches left to discover, but even these are laid out for all to see on Google Earth, identifiable by their precise latitude and longitude so that your GPS can lead you directly to them. But there is a way in which even today it is possible to be an explorer. It is not geographic exploration, but its intellectual analog, scientific exploration of the natural world. And it is this exploration that is the story of this book. It has been my fortune to have lived a scientific career of rambling exploration, a career I seem to have been destined for. My attraction to the natural world, and food, was already obvious by the time I was 2 years old. A photograph shows me with a bunch of flowers in one hand and a piece of cake in the other. By the time I was 6, I was telling people who asked that I was going to be a biologist, whatever I thought that meant. Still, the road to my eventual career was not entirely linear, nor was it a carpeted path. I endured an abysmal biology course in high school, most of which consisted of copying definitions out of the textbook and listening to the teacher denounce evolution as devil talk that contradicted the Bible. My chemistry course was even worse, taught by a part-time cotton farmer and part-time holy roller preacher who practiced his sermons on the class. He knew precious little about chemistry. Somehow, my friend Bibi and I wheedled permission to work in the stockroom while the sermons were going on. We were interested mostly in making dangerous and explosive stuff, and once we almost succeeded in blowing up the stockroom. Another high point was when we ignited a batch of thermite, creating a cascade of white-hot molten iron that burned a permanent star shape on the wooden floor. After high school, I attended a small men's college, for small men, we joked, where I was finally able to give free rein to a wide range of biological pursuits and to find like-minded students who shared my interests. At that time, the great and exciting strides in biology were being made in cell physiology and biochemistry. Thus, I applied to the graduate program in the biochemistry department at the University of California, Berkeley, only to be turned down. When, a week later, I was awarded a National Science Foundation graduate fellowship that paid full tuition, I called up the biochemistry department and asked whether they would admit me now that I had money. Sure, they said. We would love to have you. So I said, forget it, and applied to the bacteriology department, which admitted me right away. Biochemistry and bacteriology are pretty similar, and once I got into the practical laboratory part of the discipline, I gradually realized that, for me, something was missing. Where were the critters that had seduced me into biology in the first place? Where were the beautiful living things with wings, legs, leaves, colors, and forms? Could I really spend the rest of my life looking at flocculent white precipitates in a test tube? There would be a huge piece missing from my life if I continued in this field. I needed to find my way back to what had charmed me about the natural world, the creatures I could see, touch, feel, and handle, whose construction and function were beautiful. Looking back, I can see that I was trying to decide at what scale biology held the most charm for me. At the time, I saw it only as what kind of objects I wanted to deal with and where I wanted to do it. Flocculent precipitates had convinced me that my preferred scale wasn't the molecular or biochemical. This was a world of white debris, gelatinous slime, blurred bands on gels, or clear solutions that absorbed ultraviolet light. There was nothing to grasp, no form to appreciate, no movement, no behavior, not even color unless you worked on hemoglobin or vitamin B12. no one could actually see an enzyme violently clutch a substrate and wrench it and twist it until it changed chemically. The exciting things that went on in this world were constructs of the mind, built from elaborate physical and chemical measurements. My friendship with John Doyen, a graduate student in entomology, showed me a way to return to working with living creatures, not just cell-free extracts of them. John's specialty was tenebrionid beetles, a family of mostly black beetles, from tenebrous, meaning dark, with many species in the western United States. Particularly appealing was that most species produced a noxious defensive secretion that stained your fingers brown, and some of them could even spray it for distances of up to a meter. And one of them, the mealworm beetle, had even been shown to secrete a sex pheromone. Here, then, was a way to roam the western countryside to collect black beetles from under stones, collect their stinky secretion, and analyze it with the latest fancy, expensive techniques. Gas chromatography, nuclear magnetic resonance, infrared spectrometry, and ultraviolet absorption. I had found a way to apply my background in organic chemistry and biochemistry, and in addition, I got to watch the defensive behavior of the beetles and dissect hundreds of them to study and draw the structure of their beautiful glands. With respect to the sex pheromone of the mealworm beetle, I figured out how to make males copulate with glass rods treated with female pheromone. What could be more fun? At the same time, I discovered the pleasures of building contraptions that aid research. I had imported a large tenebrionid beetle from Costa Rica, but the larvae in the culture refused to pupate. Seeking a cause, I eventually showed that it was the crowding in my culture that inhibited pupation. But was the inhibition chemical, mechanical, or the result of some other process? In order to test the role of larva upon larva touch, my major professor and I built a gimmick in which slowly rotating petri dish lids dragged bathroom stopper chain over a single larva in each dish. In the controls, the stopper chain was too short to contact the larvae. The tickled larvae failed to pupate, while the untickled ones pupated quickly. This contraption, nicknamed the stimulatorium, was the first of many contraptions that gave me a lot of pleasure. Solving problems creatively and simply had revealed itself to be one of the pleasures of research, and of life beyond research. Building contraptions did not arise from my research needs, but was already part of my life. I have always liked doing things with my hands, whether building shelters or carving wood in the Boy Scouts, repairing my 1946 Ford V8 convertible, building fine furniture, or constructing palm-thatched huts. Contraptions and gizmos were really an application of this tendency, but applied to my research, they served it well. Each contraption was designed to solve a problem or answer a question, thus aiding my research. During the early years of my research, my equipment could be purchased for thousands of dollars, but I made later contraptions in my garage from wood, scraps, plastic, and salvage. These were the traits, preferences, and abilities that set me on my particular path of biological exploration, beginning with tenebrionid beetles and leading eventually to a wide interest in the natural history of ants. Almost by accident, I began my study of the subterranean architecture of ant nests, eventually broadening my quest from simply making casts of the nests of multiple species to wondering how superorganisms construct nests and why these have such a large range of forms. As I later learned, the piles of dirt on the surface did not even hint at what lay below. This book is about my quest to discover the nests that lay below these piles of dirt, how I studied these nests, how the ants constructed them, how they served the needs of the colonies, and how they differed among ant species. Although many ants also construct above-ground nests from soil, litter, or plant material, the focus of this book is only on the nests ants excavate underground. Chapter 1. Soil, Ants, and Life Underground. Under our feet lies a mysterious invisible realm. Heaps of soil in the shape of craters, mounds, or strewn pellets hint at its existence. Although many creatures burrow in soil, most of this soil is brought up from below by ants during the excavation of their nests. Ant-made soil piles occur in a wide range of habitats and locations, from the rainforests of Uganda to the sidewalks of Los Angeles, to the degree that these sidewalks exist. Because ants vary enormously in body and colony size as well as in nesting habits, these deposits range from almost invisible to the obvious mounds of fire ants or Allegheny mound-building ants, or the colossal excavations of the leafcutter ants of tropical America, which can occupy as much below-ground volume as a modest-sized house. The excavated soil tells little about the nest below. Conceivably, it suggests whether the nest is large or small, but rain, wind, and animals scatter soil piles, so even this deduction is unreliable. Nothing about the shape of the cavities, their arrangement in space, their depth, or their size is revealed by the excavated soil. Do the nests have a consistent architecture? Is there variation among ant species? How quickly do the ants create these nests? How do they use the space they create? These mysteries may not motivate many people into action, but to me, they sound a strong call. What are the ants creating underground, and how does it serve them in their lives? I am not the first biologist to ask such questions. Most of my predecessors have approached the challenge of revealing ant nest structure by first excavating nests in a range of soils, and then publishing their findings as sketches or drawings of longitudinal or cross-sections, or serial vignettes of nests. Some of these are crude sketches, some are more informative, and a few are excellent scale drawings. Most of these were incidental to other studies. As far as I know, few were motivated primarily by a desire to describe the subterranean nest architecture. But altogether, these studies give us a sort of preview of coming attractions that suggests that the study of ant nests and their role in ant biology might be very rewarding. I began studying the mysteries of ant nest architecture almost unintentionally a couple of decades ago as a side project of my regular research. As I dabbled in this subject, I was increasingly drawn into revealing these mysteries as the main focus of my research. This book is mostly about my own exploration of the underground world of ants, based on the successes and failures of my ant research in the coastal plain forests of northern Florida over the last 25 years. Far beyond merely describing ant nests, I have approached the subject broadly, integrating nest architecture with relevant bits of physics, a touch of chemistry, some soil science, ant behavior, colony biology, ant ecology, ant natural history, some experimentation, and occasional personal adventures and ruminations. I hope to show the listener the attractions, problems, and rewards of pursuing a research project with a passionate curiosity and a love of solving problems. Indeed, I have always found an aesthetic pleasure in working with the objects of nature rather than the abstract concepts that are so fashionable and admittedly important in modern biology. I believe the listener will find aesthetic pleasure in these objects too, and will be charmed by the lives of the ants that create them. I think of myself as a sort of pioneer, mapping and describing an unknown land. This is because biology always begins with a description, and it is no surprise that the infant field of ant nest architecture should begin with a description before taking up a range of brainy hypotheses to explain the observations. It is also probably no surprise that progress in research depends on having available or inventing the methods needed for answering the relevant questions. Throughout the history of science, various fields have blossomed as a result of the invention of a new instrument or process, be it the microscope, the microtome, or any number of other inventions. The field of ant nest architecture is no exception, even though the methods are simpler and more mundane than a synchrotron, a nuclear magnetic resonance instrument, or a confocal microscope. A remarkable amount of interesting stuff can be learned with shovels, plastic bags, a modest ability to count, and a homemade kiln. In an era of high-tech science, I offer a story about the pleasures of low-tech shoestring science. The ants. The creators of this mysterious underground realm are the ants. In my experience, most people are aware of ants, those pesky creatures that mob the spilled sweet drink on their kitchen counter or make dirt piles on their pristine lawns. But few are aware that the world of ants is like another universe, an alien world. It thus seems prudent to start with a brief sketch of ant biology and diversity. Ants are social insects whose ancestors diverged from the ancestors of wasps some 100 to 140 million years ago. Their societies, usually colonies, are distinguished by a strong division of function among individuals, such that only one or a few individuals are capable of laying fertilized eggs, the queen or queens, while most of the others are more or less sterile and carry out most of the work, the workers. All of the individuals with a social function are females. Males are produced only for mating with queens and are usually present for only weeks out of the year. Typically, a colony is a family whose mother is the queen and whose daughters are the workers. Daughters are full of sisters if their mother mated with a single male, and half-sisters if she mated with multiple males. At the individual level, ants are typical of insects with a complete metamorphosis, developing from egg to larva to pupa to adult. Sociality has built on this basic insect plan by affecting how ants develop into adulthood, producing either sterile workers or adults with fully developed sexual organs that are capable of mating and reproducing. Sociality has made the ants an enormously successful group of animals, dominating many ecosystems in most of the warmer parts of the world. Their biomass, that is, their total weight, often exceeds that of any other animal group in their habitat. About 14,000 species have been described, but at the rate of discovery of new species, it is likely that the final count will be 20,000 to 40,000. For example, in his exhaustive sampling of the ecosystems of Madagascar, my colleague Brian Fisher has personally discovered and named over 1,000 new ant species. When queried about the number of ant species, ant experts usually estimate between 20,000 and 30,000, reasoning that much of the world remains poorly explored for ants and other insects. Many of these new species probably already reside in museums, waiting to be described by ant taxonomists, who, unlike the ants, are in short supply. With their diversity and abundance, it is not surprising that ants occupy a wide range of habitats. Many species are scavengers and predators. Some are herders of livestock such as aphids, mealybugs, and scales. Still others are specialized predators of such tidbits as spider eggs or of difficult prey ranging from hairy millipedes to springtails. Some are communal nomadic hunters settling temporarily in camps. Some gather wild seed crops, and some farm fungus on beds of caterpillar droppings or leaf fragments. Here in the coastal plain pine forest of Florida, where I do much of my research, it is common for all of these lifestyles to be represented in a plot as small as a medium-sized suburban lot. This wealth of ant species is not evenly distributed on the earth. Rather, the number of ant species by region declines with increasing distance from the equator. Tropical regions, especially in the humid tropics, host between 4,000 and 6,000 ant species. But away from the equator, this drops rapidly, until at latitudes greater than 50 degrees north or south, there are fewer than 50 species. I once collected a sample of Leptothorax muscorum at almost 70 degrees north latitude on the Arctic slope of Alaska north of the Brooks Range. Only two ant species in the Arctic region extend from North America across Siberia, and the colony I found was nesting in a rare sandy bank facing south, soaking up every calorie of sunshine it could get, perched as it was only a few centimeters above the permafrost. In winter, the nest and everything in it froze solid, a life on hold, not to be resumed until the spring thaw. Its life could define the word tenuous. Of course, larger areas have more ant species. so equivalent-sized countries must be compared. Ecuador and Finland are not very different in size, but Ecuador has over 700 ant species, while Finland is home to only 64 species. An area of 16 hectares in the Peruvian Amazon yielded almost 500 species of ants. Brazil and the United States are pretty similar in size, yet the United States has only about 800 species, while Brazil has over 1,400. And once Brazil is fully explored, it will probably yield many more. Myrmecologists have speculated and argued for decades about which group of insects gave rise to the ants. For a long time, the consensus was that the closest relative of the ants was a wasp-like creature, similar to modern typhid wasps. These wasps seek out the larvae of beetles, paralyze them with a sting, and then lay an egg on them. The larva hatching from this egg then grows and develops by consuming the beetle larva. More recently, molecular methods have been used to determine the degree of relatedness of various insect groups and to arrange them into family trees, phylogenetic trees. Basically, the sequence of base pairs in the DNA groups of organisms changes with time, so the number of pairs in a long DNA sequence that differ is a measure of both the time, more or less, the two lines have evolved separately, and the degree to which they are or are not related. Recent studies of many families of ants, bees, and wasps have shown that ants are most closely related to bees and stinging wasps. In the language of taxonomists, they are sister groups. Bees, of course, collect and feed on pollen, whereas ants, at least the more primitive ants, and most wasps are carnivorous or parasitic. However, what ants, most bees, and most stinging wasps have in common is that they build or find nests and bring stuff, pollen, prey, nest material, back to the nest. Wasps outside this group tend to find their prey and parasitize it in place rather than haul it back to a central place. The collection of stuff is probably the part of the life history and behavior that predisposes these sister groups to evolve sociality, because it makes parents and offspring more likely to associate in the nest. Given other favorable factors, this group can evolve sociality. It is notable that sociality has evolved 6 to 8 separate times in the bees and once in the ancestral ant, all of whose descendants are social. Nest construction thus facilitated the evolution of sociality, because living in a nest and returning stuff to it predisposes insects to form related groups and thus evolve cooperative behavior. In other words, nesting behavior predates the evolution of both ants and sociality. Modern social insects share a particular set of life history features, that is, characteristics of the stages and phases of their life cycle, and ways in which these meet the life challenges of the species. 1. Daughters remain in the nest with their mother and sisters. Generations overlap. 2. Sisters care for younger sisters rather than their own offspring, communal brood care, and coincidentally care for their mother too. 3. Some individuals specialize in laying eggs and others in rearing them and doing other necessary work, division of labor or function. It is easy to imagine that a mother ant, bee, or wasp that repeatedly hauls stuff back to the nest to feed to her developing offspring would eventually share that nest with her adult daughters, and they with their younger and contemporary sisters. The presence of a brood would trigger the brood-tending behavior of the sisters, and various nutritional and perhaps hormonal conditions would suppress the reproductive capability of the daughters. Should such a combination of a mother, queen, and her suppressed daughters, workers, be more successful in producing the next generation than the daughters trying it on their own, then this nascent sociality would be favored by natural selection, and social evolution would be on its way. Such social evolution eventually passes a point of no return when the workers are no longer capable of being queens, as happened in the ants. After that point, ants were no longer able to ask, "Should I be social or should I go it alone?" They were irreversibly committed. In addition to nest construction and stuff collection, a particular mode of sex determination in these hymenopterans predisposes them to become social. Whereas females develop from fertilized eggs like most animals, males develop from unfertilized eggs. This means that females are diploid, have two sets of chromosomes, and males are haploid, have one set. All of the male's sperm carries the same set of genes. If the queen mates with a single male, math tells us that sisters are 75% related to one another, that is, 75% of their genes are the same, whereas they are only 25% related to their brothers. So if sisters are going to help each other reproduce, they are surely not going to include their less related brothers. The very high relatedness among sisters makes forfeiting their own reproduction to help their sisters reproduce pay off, genetically speaking, because their sisters bear so many of the same genes. Multiple fathers decrease the strength of this selection, but once sociality evolves, even this confers some advantages. In any case, the high relatedness among females produces a strong selective pressure to evolve sociality. And this is one reason all female sociality evolved 7 to 9 times in this evolutionary lineage. Ant nests. Ant nest architecture originated about 100 to 140 million years ago when the ancestor of all modern ants dug the ancestor of all modern ant nests. Today, the many thousands of ant species and their nests are the descendants of this ancestral ant and her nest. However, in the humid tropics, about half of the ant species nest in trees, often reaching a huge abundance. I once fogged 2 rainforest trees in Guyana with a knockdown insecticide to collect the arthropods living in them. About 90% of the resulting rain of insects onto our collecting sheets were ants, and most were a single, superdominant species of Azteca. With increasing latitude both north and south, ant species nest less frequently in trees and more frequently in the ground. This shift probably occurs because of the seasonally harsh desiccating and/or freezing conditions of life in trees in temperate climates. At my latitude in Florida, only a few of the 100 or so species nest only in trees. Most nest in the ground or in rotting wood, or make temporary nests in existing shelters. Each of the ground-nesting ant species builds a more or less distinctive nest, differing not only in size, but also in architectural details from those of other species. In modern biology, these differences are best explained by evolution. A 1973 essay by the evolutionary biologist Theodosius Dobzhansky of fruit fly genetics fame was titled, "Nothing in Biology Makes Sense Except in the Light of Evolution." By this, he meant that there is overwhelming evidence that all life on Earth is related and can be arranged into family trees that make sense as the outcomes of evolutionary descent. Evolutionary explanations are a core of modern biology, from molecules to behaviors to societies. The diversity of ant nest architecture, like the diversity of organisms, must also be the outcome of evolution, and can therefore be arranged, at least in theory, into family trees that show lines of descent of closely related organisms or architectures as branches. To work toward this goal with respect to nest architecture, the listener will have to allow me a good deal of latitude because my sample size is small. Nevertheless, the exercise can be educational and is undertaken in Chapter 9. From the outset, I must make clear that what evolved is not the ant nest, which is just hollow space in dirt, but the behavior of the ants that dig the nest. The nest is essentially the product or fossil of the ant's behavior. Much complexity is hidden in this simple claim, for behavior includes not only the lone actions of individual workers, but also how these workers are affected by the behavior of other workers and by the cues and feedbacks emanating from the nest as it is constructed by dozens to millions of workers in the dark, without a leader or a blueprint. It is, in the currently popular phrase, self-organizing. How this self-organization works during nest excavation is largely still a mystery, but is one of the central questions of the field. The medium. To those of us who move freely in sunlight and air, soil is the dense granular medium on which we walk, in which plants are rooted, on which our houses are built and on which we place asphalt and parking lots. We have no experience that would allow us to imagine moving through soil. Most creatures that live in soil move through it by creating cavities, and much of this activity involves excavating soil and dumping it on the surface, out of the way. This is what ants do when they create their subterranean nests. But most soils also have abundant empty pore space, and some soil-dwelling creatures are so small that they can move in the spaces between soil clumps or grains. Or they can exploit the ample pore space by pressing grains aside to gain passage. Some ants, such as the minuscule thief ants, are so small that they are probably capable of doing this. Their wide-ranging, dispersed, thread-like passages are rarely accompanied by soil dumps on the surface. When these passages intersect with the nests of larger ants, the thief ants steal and eat the brood of the larger ants. In the coastal plains of Florida, soils barely qualify as soils among soil scientists, who describe them as mere sedimentary deposits because they show little or no formation of zones or horizons. Indeed, most of the coastal plains are stranded coastal dunes running more or less parallel to the current shore. The lower interdune valleys form a network of sluggish streams that gradually drain the shallow water table to the Gulf of Mexico. An elevation difference of 1 to 2 meters separates the wetlands from the dry uplands. The wetland soils are dark, organic, and mucky, while the upland soils are almost pure sand, with charcoal dust darkening the top 10 centimeters to gray. This soil is so sterile that no farmer, native or immigrant, was ever foolish enough to try to farm it, reprieving the pine forest from destruction. Competition for nutrients is intense because 85% of the nutrients are in the top 15 centimeters of soil. Getting a share of these nutrients on their way down to the water table requires plants to capture them before their neighbors do. Roots are sparse below about 20 centimeters. This is the environment in which I began my field studies of ants, lured by the diverse and abundant ant fauna that proclaimed its presence, like name tags, through distinct patterns of soil dumps. It seemed likely that this surface distinction also reflected distinction underground, and it was this underground distinction that I wanted to reveal. Chapter 2. Revealing the Shape of Empty Spaces. Ant nests are hollow spaces within soil, air surrounded by soil. The notion of filling a hidden empty space to show what shape it is must have occurred to people many times through human history. Of course, it works only if the mold can be removed from around the filled space. It first occurred to me that this could be applied to ant nests when I was a young assistant professor in the 1970s. I remembered that the circulatory systems of frogs and sharks that we dissected in anatomy class came filled with red or blue latex. So, I ordered some latex and had my undergraduate student, Grayson Chip Brown, try to make a nest cast with it. He poured the latex into the opening of an ant nest in the backyard of his rented house, waited for it to harden, and then dug it out. The result was a really nice cast, like pancakes on a stick, almost 2 meters deep, with the problematic feature that it was floppy, made of rubber as it was. We identified the ant as the cone ant, Conomyrma flavipecta, now Dorymyrmex berani, and put the cast in a laboratory drawer where it remained for 15 years or more, to be hauled out occasionally for visitors and eventually disappearing during a move of my laboratory. My urge to cast ant nests was reawakened in the mid-1980s after two USDA biologists, David Williams and Cliff Lofgren, published a brief paper on the use of dental plaster to make ant nest casts. This orthodontic plaster was much stronger than plaster of Paris, dried hard and stiff, and was a huge improvement over floppy latex. Moreover, it was cheap, available in 25 or 50-pound boxes, and mixed with water it set in about 30 minutes. I bought some plaster to make a cast of a fire ant nest. After having excavated over 100 such nests, I expected that the nest would consist of randomly located and connected small chambers. Using a pretty low-tech process, I poured a half bucket of plaster slurry into a fire ant nest, dug up a 20-kilogram hunk of dirt and plaster, and took it home to wash off the soil with a hose to reveal the shape of the empty space. It was an eyebrow raiser, for I hadn't imagined it correctly at all. In place of the rather random structure I had imagined, the cast revealed a clearly organized structure of repeated vertical shafts connecting horizontal chambers into many distinct vertical series, often with horizontal connections between chambers as well. I hung the cast from the ceiling of my office, where it amazed visitors for 3 decades. This minor epiphany opened my eyes to the potential of effective nest casting methods for studying ant nest architecture. This potential was apparent even from the single plaster cast I had made. In 3 dimensions, it revealed every detail of architecture the way a print reveals every detail of a negative. Up until then, the occasional studies on ant nest architecture had relied on sketches or scale drawings of excavations. But imagining these nests in 3 dimensions was challenging. In comparison, viewing a 3-dimensional nest cast seemed almost magical. It could be viewed from any angle, with each view contributing to an image of the whole. Plaster certainly had its limitations, such as fragility, but for the time being, plaster set me on the road to studying ant nest architecture. Along the way, this basic method, combined with other methods, allowed me to delve into related areas of ant behavior, colony biology, evolution, and ecology, all of which I will touch on to paint a more unified picture. The cast that got me hooked. In the next few years, I sought out and cast a handful of nests of several ant species, but my hands were full with my fire ant research, so this stayed an interesting sideline until, in 1999, I poured a 5-gallon bucket of dental plaster slurry into a recently abandoned Florida harvester ant nest. It took the full 5 gallons, filling the nest to a depth of 2.5 meters. Digging it out took 2 days and resulted in almost 150 pieces of cast, a giant 3-dimensional jigsaw puzzle that I carried home in several large trays. In retrospect, my decision to mount and reconstruct this cast was founded on my complete lack of imagination regarding what it would take to put all the pieces together. I built a plywood base and back, painted it blue, got a lot of thin, stiff metal rods, found a location for the cast in the building in which I worked, and started the reconstruction. The cast had to be constructed from the top down, so the first problem was to estimate how tall it would end up being. I settled for just short of 8 feet, as that was the length of the plywood sheet and the depth of the hole left after the excavation. In my excess of enthusiasm during excavation, I had failed to mark the origin of the many pieces, and this was further complicated by the presence of 4 separate shafts. Just as in assembling blue sky in a jigsaw puzzle, one looks for small variants in the outlines of the pieces, the precise shapes of the breaks could be fit together without doubt after trying many combinations. Another feature that sorted chambers into distinct and mutually exclusive groups was the color they took on from their location in the soil column. Like the soil in the colony's sandhill site, the chambers from the top 15 to 20 centimeters were dirty gray. Those from the next meter or more were yellow, and then they became pure white. So I never had to test whether a white piece fit with a yellow or gray one. It also soon became apparent that the shafts were smooth helices, like spiral staircases. So junctions that made sharp changes of direction were clearly incorrect. By placing the broken ends of candidate pieces together and gradually turning them, I would suddenly make a perfect fit. The only thing missing was an audible click. Then came the mixing of the epoxy, followed by gluing the pieces together with careful support to maintain the exact position until the glue hardened. The top region of the nest was so interconnected that it was recovered as one single, if very complex, piece. I placed it upside down on the lab bench and reconstructed the cast upside down for about 30 centimeters. Things were going well until my student lab assistant spun around with a backpack and shattered the partially reconstructed cast into about 50 pieces. Like Sisyphus, I started up that hill again, and after a couple of weeks, step by step, the cast regained its earlier level of reconstruction, though with more glue joints. At this point, it was necessary to mount the cast against the backboard by means of stout metal rods, a tense process during which my daughter Erica helped hold and stabilize it. With the upper cast region in place, reconstruction continued downward, each piece supported by a metal rod projecting from the backboard, each glue joint having to fully harden before the next piece could be fit. I also built some sub-assemblies separate from the main cast and added them as more complex units. In this way, the cast gradually took form over 2 months or more. It was not work for the fidgety. The result, however, was magnificent, revealing an unsuspected beauty and order that made me want to reveal more such beauty in other nests and display it for others to see. There were two large barriers to realizing this desire. First, the daunting amount of work it took to reassemble a large plaster cast, and second, the obvious fragility of the reassembled cast. There was no way such a cast could be moved. The search for better materials and some adventures. Thus began the hunt for a stronger casting material. Adding glass fibers or other additives to the plaster helped a little, but not enough. Hardening plastics were out because they were true liquids and would soak into the sand and make an unnaturally bloated cast. It had to be metal. But which metal, and how to melt it in the field right next to the nest to be cast? Having stayed awake in high school physics class now paid dividends. I recalled Newton's law of cooling, which said that the rate of heat transfer increases with the temperature difference between a hot and a cold material. Any molten metal poured into a nest would lose heat to the surrounding sand as it flowed down, and other things being equal, the higher the melting point, the faster the rate of heat loss, and the sooner the metal would freeze. Therefore, high melting point metals would fill much less of the nest before freezing than low melting point ones.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.